Oh, and good morning to everyone. I just wanted to welcome everybody and thank you for coming out and worshiping with us this morning. We're going to do things just a tad bit differently. We've got a worship video that we're going to start out with this morning. It's an invitation and a challenge to come and worship our good and glorious God. So if you wouldn't mind, I think the words will be in with the video with us. We're going to start out with that, and then Brother David is going to sing us a few worship songs after the announcements this morning. So I'd have all of you to just stand and join with us, and we'll praise along to this worship video, and then Brother David will sing us a few worship songs afterwards.
Pray that that's the
Amen. The answer that we have this morning, that we would come. And I'm thankful that that's the way that we can come.
Amen.
As we are.
Glory to God.
We don't have to be fit and perfect.
Amen.
We just need to come faithful and trusting. Amen. Lord, and let today be that day that we all confess that Jesus Christ is King. Amen.
Amen.
Just a couple of short announcements. Want to let everyone know of a family benefit that we're going to have for the Brown family, for Ms. Pam. It's going to be Saturday, September 26th. It's going to be from 3 to 6. And it's going to be here at the Abundant Life Family Worship Center. And this fundraiser is going to be a barbecue chicken fundraiser to help raise money to cover the amount of medical expenses that were built up. As we all know, Pastor Head had several months and several trips of hospital visits. And we also know how those bills can add up quickly from the hospitals. So we're having this benefit to help support Ms. Pam, the Brown family, to help cover some of those expenses. Again, that's going to be Saturday, September 26th from 3 to 6 here at Abundant Life Worship Center. Also, Operation Christmas Child, September. We're collecting socks and chapsticks for the shoe boxes, and still continuing to accept donations for the shipping and the gospel tracts there also. And as a reminder, just always so thankful for everyone's prayer and support of that wonderful ministry that's there. Our prayer list, we have Mary Barber, Tina Smith, Joanne Rowland, Lexi Owens, Jerry Fullington, and Brother Glenn Dennison also to continue to pray for. And so we will be in remembrance of those folks also. And those are the few announcements that we have this morning. So if you will, join with me and let's just go before the Lord and thank Him for being in His house of worship today. And just thank Him for the work He's going to do through the service today. Let's join with Him. Father in heaven, Lord, we are so thankful and so grateful for the blessings of this opportunity to gather together once again. And Father, I just pray that, Lord, that we would look to You, Father, this morning. And Lord, that we would be open and honest before You, Father, Lord, and we've all fallen short. Lord, we admit and we confess that this morning. But Father, we thank You for Your love, grace, and mercy. And we thank You this morning for Your Son, Jesus Christ.
Glory.
Lord, who lived in perfection, Lord, that we could not live. Lord, by His life, gave a ransom for each and every one of us. Lord, that we could come to You, Father. Lord, through faith and trust in Your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, in all confidence, knowing, Lord, that we can come before You, Lord, seeking forgiveness for our sin. Lord, in the times that we've fallen short. Lord, we thank You for that grace and mercy that covers us. We thank You for the blood of Your Son, Jesus Christ, that covers us today as we faithfully trust in Him. Lord, that through that righteousness, Father, Lord, that we are brought close to You, Father. Lord, that we have all confidence knowing, Lord, that You're in this place together. Lord, and I just pray that as we worship and honor and glorify and magnify Your holy name today, Father, You would prepare our hearts to receive the truth of Your word today, Father. Lord, may Your anointed word, Lord, accomplish to the fullest what You have purposed it, Father. Lord, may we be prepared to receive it and to grab hold of it, Father. Lord, apply it to our lives, Father. Lord, and carry it out of this place, Father, and seek to live out the truth of Your word that we hear today. Lord, we just thank You and we praise You in the name of Your Son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord.
Amen.
Look at that. That thing's fell over. Praise God. You know what? That was a great opening song there. Because now is the time. It's the time we've set aside every Sunday to come and praise and worship Him. I'm going to be doing a few songs, but I need some audience participation. I need a little bit. This is a big word for me. Because I'm just a redneck boy. I need some enthusiasm out of you guys.
Amen.
If you don't know what that is, it's a strong excitement or feeling. And I feel excited when I come into the house of the Lord.
Amen.
It's a something inspiring zeal or fervor. And this word, if you study back, it started out in religion, this word did. It was a belief. Before it got to be in the world, it was a belief in special revelations of the Holy Spirit. Now, that's what enthusiasm was. You believe that the Spirit of God can move in here this morning. I want you to show forth a little enthusiasm, okay?
Amen.
Come on, don't just sit there like a pump on a log. But let's just get in here and praise God this morning.
Amen.
I'm going to try to sing a little. My music is a little different because I'm a little different. But, you know, we've all got different positions in the kingdom of God. And right now, if you feel like shouting, clapping your hands, praising God in your own way, I invite you to show forth that word enthusiasm this morning.
Amen.
Praise God. I got to turn on this first. There I go. You can probably hear me anyway. I'm loud. in this message. Because I feel his presence. Amen. Glory to God. I'm going to do one more. I'm going to get a sip of this water. Jesus said he was living water, didn't he?
Amen.
Going to get this out of here. I'm going to get over here. My hearing is not that good. I'm going to get by the speaker where I can hear it. This song, I hope you enjoy it, called Daystar.
shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night. Jesus, shine down on me. Let your love shine through me in the night.
Worship him. He's worthy this morning.
Amen.
Praise your name, Jesus. Glory to God. Glory to God. Praise God. I'm going to get this out of the way. He might want to do some running or something. I don't know. You never know. Praise God.
Amen. Aren't we thankful for Jesus who does shine down on us? Amen. It is out of his love, grace, his mercy, and his compassion for us that
yes,
he does that today. Here you go, brother. Here's you.
I had a word on there. This is my dictionary now.
Amen.
More than just a fold.
Amen. Praise God. But there was something that he said that really stuck out to me this morning. That he can take what's wrong and make it right. Amen.
Amen.
Do you believe that today?
Woo, glory.
He can.
Amen. Only, come on.
Not only can he, but he does. If we allow him to. He can take what's wrong and make it right. If have any children that have them to come forward this morning, ask blessings over our children and tithes and offerings.
Bless them, Lord. Hallelujah.
Amen. We're always so thankful to God for what these children has blessed us with. And let's continue to remain faithful and thank Him for these children. And thank Him for what He's going to do as they gather together in their classes and learn of Him. And also our tithes and offerings. Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, we come to you once again, Father. We thank you for these children. Lord, we thank you every Sunday because we can never thank you enough. Lord, we recognize and we understand how blessed of a gift they are for our families and our church family. Father, we just continue to thank you for the work that you're doing in their lives. We thank you for the teachers who take the time to speak the truth of your love and faithfulness to them, Father. Lord, that they may grow in love and faithfulness towards you, Father. Lord, that they would increase in faith and trust and draw closer in relationship with you. And Father, I just pray that you would anoint them as they gather together into the classes to receive the fullness of who you are, Father. We just thank you for the work that you're going to do in each and every one of them. Father, we thank you for the opportunity we have, Lord, to just bless your wonderful name through tithes and offerings. Lord, we give, acknowledging, Father, everything we have is of you. So out of that, Father, we give with gratitude and thanksgiving, Father. Lord, and I pray that we do so, that it might bring honor and glory to your name, that you would be pleased to multiply it and to bless it. We just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You got your Bibles with you this morning. I'd like for you to join along with me looking at Genesis chapter 32. We're going back to the very beginning of God's word this morning. And while you're turning there, it's really a blessing to hear that that old but always joy song to hear, Amazing Grace. A song that's been around a long time and it's been sung many times. But every time I have the opportunity to sing that song, it fills me with joy and thanksgiving once again. Because a lot of times we can easily forget about the wonderful gift of God's grace in our lives. And how unwarranted, unmerited, and absolutely undeserved.
Come on, yes.
There's nothing we can do to receive it, but it is a free gift.
Amen.
Given to us. Given freely out of pure love. And that's what I would like for us to talk about this morning is the grace of God and how sometimes we hinder the operation of His grace in our lives. Looking at Genesis chapter 32, I'd like to start at, we'll start at verse 9. We'll read a couple of three verses here and go, Lord, in prayer. So starting in verse 9 there, it says, "And Jacob said, O God of my father Abraham, God of my father Isaac, the Lord which saith unto me, return into thy country and to thy kindred, and I will deal well with thee. I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies and of all the truth which thou hast showed unto thy servant. For with that my staff I passed over this Jordan, and now I have become two bands. Deliver me, I pray thee, from the hand of my brother, from the hand of Esau, for I fear him, lest he will come and smite me, and the mother with the children. And thou sayest, I will surely do thee good, and make thy seed as the sand of the sea, which cannot be numbered for the multitude." Let's go, Lord, in prayer. Father in heaven, Lord, I thank you for this blessed opportunity we have to open up the truth of your word. Father, I pray that it would be sweet as honey to our lips, Father. Lord, that we would desire to receive the understanding that you would have us to have today, Father. Lord, help us to understand, Father. Lord, remind us today, Father, how blessed we are to have your grace and mercy upon us, Father. How your loving kindness and your compassion, Father, falls upon us. Lord, let us not forsake it or take it for granted, Father. Let us not lose sight, Father, how that grace and that mercy that you so bless us with, Father, is given so freely. Lord, as we look to your Son, Jesus Christ, as our Lord and Savior, I just thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Several years ago, there was a message that I was sharing with the youth group. And as I was sharing this message, I got to a certain point, and there's this young man who began to snort and snicker at what I was sharing with him. Later on, he came to me and he apologized for the laughing and cutting up that he had done. And what it was that I was discussing with him is I was making mention of this little chapel that's in Italy that contained what is called the Scala Sancta. Scala Sancta stands for sacred stairs. And these stairs are the very steps that Jesus climbed whenever he stood trial before Pilate. And since that day, for centuries on, there have been faithful pilgrims that come and repeat the climbing of those stairs. But they don't just walk up those stairs. They ascend up each and every step on their knees. And as they go to each step, they pause to pray at each and every one of the 28 little marble steps that consist of those stairs. So climbing the Scala Sancta, or the sacred stairs, it was taught that this gains penitence, what was called a plenary indulgence, or in other words, a full pardon from temporal punishments for their sins. It was a way that, it was an act that people performed in order to attempt to get forgiveness or find atonement for their sins. Even to this very day, no one is permitted to stand on those steps. Pilgrims, they ascend up the steps on their knees, and then there's a stairway to exit on the other side. And when I talked about this, this piece is when this young man in the youth group began to snort and snicker. I told him of a story of a boy that was in Rome, and every week his mother would make him climb this scala sancta, or these sacred stairs. And every week as that boy climbed the stairs, she stood to the side weeping and wringing of her hands and was praying for his soul. And that was her way of getting this young boy to atone, to make payment, or to have atonement, to be able to receive a pardon or forgiveness for his sins of that week. And I admire her dedication for her son, but I cannot and I do not agree with that theology. Because this type of act is what gives a score to legalism. And the thing is there's far too many Christians that do similar things in a legalistic manner. And it's just in our blood to do so, to feel obligated that we can and that we should do something of our own accord to make penitence or to make atonement for our sins. And it's just something that seems to come natural, as though it's in our blood. We even see this happening all the way back to Adam and Eve, who had this self-justifying act of trying to cover themselves with fig leaves for loincloths. Instead of approaching God as empty-handed charity cases, many people who have this legalistic approach God as though there's some type of religious success story, and that their accomplishments of what they've done warrants them a paycheck of grace. But God is always busy working in trying to knock this thinking and this theology that's out of us. And that's why I turned to Genesis 32 here to look at a good example of Jacob, who followed along the same lines that many Christians do today. Jacob here in Genesis 32, it tells us a very strange story of the day that Jacob wrestled with God. So looking at verse 32 here, we see what is happening here is that Jacob is about to collide with his brother that he had cheated years ago. And he's dreadful of the severity of Esau's justice, and he begins to look desperately for a solution for his circumstances. And the first idea that comes to Jacob's mind is a grace-based prayer. So looking back in verse 9 that we just read, it says this, "And Jacob said, O God of my father Abraham, and God of my father Isaac, the Lord which saith unto me, Return unto thy country and thy kindred, and I will deal well with thee. He says, I am not worthy of the least of all the mercies, and of all the truth which thou hast showed unto thy servant." So he acknowledges that the grace and mercy that God has shown him that he is not worthy of. He acknowledges that it is not anything that he did of himself that warranted the grace and mercies that was upon him. In verse 10, he confesses, I am unworthy of all loving kindness. And that word here is hesed. The hesed refers to God's policy of bestowing benefits on those that do not deserve them.
Come on now, yes.
Bestowing benefits to those that do not deserve them or have not earned them.
Yes, amen.
In other words, free grace.
Praise God.
The Word of God in Hebrews, it's talking in the realms and the vocabulary of grace here. Jacob's prayer is eat up with some excellent theology in God's Word. The only solution that he had in the judgment that was coming from his brother was to appeal to the grace of God.
Yes, amen.
And that is true for us today. That the only hope, the only means that we have to, the only solution that we have to the judgment that is upon us today because of our sin is that grace of God. That bestowed benefit of His Son Jesus Christ that is not warranted and not earned today. But the only problem with Jacob is he started out on the right note, looking to God in His grace and mercy, reminding God of His goodness to him and appealing to the grace of God. He starts out great, but it's too bad that he didn't stick with his first thoughts. Immediately after having this beautiful prayer appealing to God, Jacob does something that many of us have a tendency to do with God today. He tries to buy his grace.
Come on now.
He tries to earn grace by his own measures. If you'll turn over to me with me and look on to verses chapter 13, we see here a situation where he turns to what many do today. They turn to their own devices to try to merit grace in their lives. Looking in verse 13, says, "And he lodged there some night and took of that which came to his hand, a present for Esau, his brother. 200 she-goats, 20 he-goats, 200 ewes, 20 rams, 30 milch camels with their colts, 40 kine, 10 bulls, 20 she-asses, and 10 foals. And he delivered them into the hand of his servants, every drove by themselves, and said unto his servants, Pass over before me, and put a space betwixt drove and drove. And he commanded the foremost, saying, When Esau my brother meeteth thee, and asketh thee, saying, Whose art thou, and whither goest thou, and whose are these before thee? Then thou shalt say, They be thy servant Jacob's. It is a present sent unto my lord Esau, and behold also, he is behind us. And so commanded he the second and the third and all that followed the drove, saying, On this matter shall you speak unto Esau when you find him, and say ye moreover, Behold, thy servant Jacob is behind us. For he said, I will appease him with the present that goeth before me. And afterward I will see his face, and peradventure he will accept me. Let me read that last part of verse 20. It says here, I will appease him with the present that go before me. And I will see his face, and peradventure he will accept me.
Come on.
So he got up this big, wonderful gift as a payment for grace. And so many times, he started out so well. He appealed to God, looking for him to find grace in the circumstance that he was in. But he made a U-turn and immediately resorted to trying to earn the grace of his brother by his own means. By his own means. Jacob, he tells us here in verse 20, I will appease him with the present that goes before me. And the Hebrew word that's translated here is kathar, which means to atone. You see the semblance here. He is trying to pay for his atonement for the wrongs that he had done to his brother. And we try to do the same thing. We Christians today, we try to do the same things. We hear it preached that the grace and mercy of God is freely given to us, and it is received through faith and trust in Jesus Christ. But yet so many Christians today try to turn to their own devices and their own means to try to earn and try to warrant a paycheck of grace for God on their behalf. It's the same thing that Jacob tries to do with his brother here. You see, Jacob had mastered this fine art of self-atonement. And this manipulative act underkept everything that he had just prayed to the Lord previously. And just as the same, many Christians today, we give lip service to God's grace, but we often treat God like a judge who is still trying to calculate our sins and our punishment against us. We often think maybe if I go on a mission trip, or give more money to the church, or I get a hold of these bad habits I have, then maybe God will accept me. That if I do these things, that I will find grace and mercy in the eyes of God. We'll either take our stand on the all-sufficiency of Christ's atoning work, or we will try to take a stand on our self-atoning efforts. But every time we choose the latter, we become what I would say is a poster child for what's called legalism. And that is looking to ourselves to find ways that we can earn forgiveness for our sins. And this is where we get to the point to where God steps in. And we've heard the story of the encounter with Jacob as he wrestles with God. As Jacob was waiting in solitude in the early morning light, there's where this showdown between God and Jacob happens. God enters in as an angel and picks a fight with Jacob. Now let me ask you this question. Why is it that God would pick on Jacob at the lowest, what seemingly is the lowest time of his life? Is he that hard-hearted? I don't believe so. God intervened in a time when God saw it was necessary to expose Jacob's self-reliance so that God could finally pin that issue to the mat and once and for all set Jacob free from that. I can relate to Jacob's circumstances. I think it was just a Sunday or two ago that I had mentioned my own fleshly weakness years ago, thinking that I could rely on my own devices to make ends meet. Jacob thought the same thing. Jacob's wrestling with God kind of depicts his true spirit. Jacob had this delusion and this thinking that many Christians carry with them today. This thinking that if it's going to be, it's up to me.
Come on now.
Or I've heard this before. God helps those who help themselves. God helps those who help themselves. If that were true, I would be in bad shape because I have managed to get myself in some absolutely helpful circumstances. The only way Jacob knew to obtain a blessing from God was by winning it in a fight. And fight Jacob did.
Come on now.
Jacob's core problem was that just like so many believers today, it was a redefinition of who God is. And out of that was this misunderstanding of what was required of him to get anything out of God. Instead of viewing God as a loving father that he is, who longed to bless Jacob, Jacob viewed him as though he was some type of stepfather that he had to coax or force or to wrestle with to make God give him something that was any good, that was to give him any kind of blessing. Jacob became physically what he had always been spiritually. He became a disabled charity case. We often look to God and think that we can force God's hand to give us that which we think we desire or we think that we need from God. A lot of times we stubbornly insist on offering God our winningness or our accomplishments or our achievements, things that we've done as a way to receive blessings from God. And that was kind of Jacob's MO. But God had finally had enough with Jacob. And that's when he more or less got in Jacob's face and more or less told him, you really think that you can win a blessing from me, that you can earn a blessing from me? And Jacob was bold enough to try. He put forth the best effort he had to try to wrestle with God to get his blessing. And the funny thing is, so many of us view Jacob's wrestling as a virtue. But in truth, it was not really a virtue. It was actually foolish of Jacob to think that he could wrestle with God to get what he thought he needed, to get God's blessing. Because you see, God does not bless us on the basis of our performance. If he did, we would be in so much trouble. So much trouble. It's not our wrestling. It's not our goodness. It's not how moral or decent we are. It's not how religious we are. It's not how much penance that we give today. It's not the amount of sacrifice that we make. It's not the amount of good works that we do. It's not anything but Jesus Christ and his shed blood on the cross that brings, that merits God's blessings in our lives. Amen. But Jacob didn't understand this. Even after hours of wrestling with God, Jacob still didn't get it. So God finally showed Jacob the true measure of his strength. It was in an instant that everything changed for Jacob. Jacob thought he was getting somewhere, so he fought and fought and fought. And as long as he thought he was getting somewhere with God, to accomplishing, fighting for God for his blessing, he continued. And finally, God showed him his strength, and that's when everything changed. God dislocated Jacob's thigh simply by touching it. Isn't that something? How Jacob wrestled and wrestled and wrestled with God, thinking maybe that he was accomplishing something, thinking that maybe he was had this ability to force God's hand in anything. But finally, God said enough, and just with a touch, ended the fight right there. And finally, that's when an epiphany must have came to Jacob. When that light switch flipped and Jacob realized that he was never going to be successful in wrestling with God to get what he thought that he needed. It's proof that, it even shows proof that the only reason that Jacob lasted so long as he did with God is because God was just going easy on him. God thought, well, Jacob, if you think you can wrestle, then wrestle your little heart out. And he did. He wrestled and wrestled and wrestled to the point where finally God said, okay, now, let me show you how this is really going to go down. That was it. Game over for Jacob. Can you imagine how Jacob felt after he tried for so long and so hard to force God's hand to get that blessing that he needed to save him from the circumstances he was in with his brother, to realize that just in an instant it was all over. How long will we as Christians have to try to work and wrestle and fight in our own means, to try to do things in our own way, to try and force God's hand and try to earn a paycheck of God's grace for His grace and mercy in our life? But the thing happened here is that there was a switch that flipped with Jacob. And it's the same switch that God is trying to wrestle with us to flip in our lives also. You see, Jacob went from wrestling to clinging. With his hip in the shape that it was in, he could no longer fight and wrestle with God. So what did he do? He just hung on to him and he clung to him. And that's the point, I believe, of the story. It's not the virtue of wrestling, but it's the virtue of clinging today. Clinging to God. Clinging to Jesus Christ. Clinging to the cross. Clinging on to God's promises and His Word. When we're too tired to wrestle, what do? You cling. If you've seen those boxing matches or those wrestling matches, you know, they'll get in there and they'll dig it out for a few rounds, but when they get tired and worn out, what do? They start clinging on to one another, don't they? When they can't wrestle anymore, they just start kind of to cling on to one another. And this clinging, I believe, represents faith, that Jacob finally got it. He switched from trying to, what I would call earning a paycheck, to asking God for a blessing. And from that time on, Jacob could never again pat his own back as an able-bodied victor receiving his blessings. Jacob suddenly became physically what he had always been spiritually, a permanently disabled charity case. He always thought that he could do things by his own means. He started out good with a grace-based prayer, asking God for his blessing to help him in the circumstances he was in. But then he immediately reverted to trying to earn that grace by his own merits. He tried to get it by his brother by giving off all of these gifts. And then he tried to get it by his own accord by wrestling with God. But he finally came to the point of realizing that his own efforts was not going to bring about God's blessings. We see in verse 26, he said, "I will not let you go unless you bless me." And this here is not a claim of victory, but an admission of defeat and a pursuit of God's grace.
Amen.
He began, instead of wrestling with God, saying, "God, you're going to bless me," he realized that he needed to hang on to God and ask God and beg God for that blessing. And we as Christians, we need to be doing that same thing today.
Yes.
Instead of looking to our own efforts and saying, "God, bless me because of what I have done," realize that nothing we can do earns us God's blessing.
Amen.
But through faith and trust in Jesus Christ, we go to God and we seek God's grace and mercy, who He says He gives freely to
yes.
us.
Yes, amen. Praise God.
And God does this so that we cannot take pride, we cannot glory in what we have done for God as though God owes us something, because God owes us absolutely nothing.
Amen.
Last I recall, it was God who sent His Son for us.
Yes. Amen.
The Bible tells us that our works are as filthy rags.
Amen. Now, come on.
There is no value of anything that we think that we could do with God. The only value that we have today is the blood of Jesus Christ that covers us through faith and trust in Him.
Amen.
That is the only value that we have. But that is a blessed value that we have, that Jesus sees, is that covering of Jesus Christ. As Jesus stands in heaven, intervening on our behalf. Again, it's not a claim of victory, but it is an admission of defeat and a pursuit of grace that Jacob has here. And this prayer is coming from a now humbled heart. and a humbled heart prevails with God. It's in that moment that Jacob died to his self-deserving ways. He died to his self-reliance. He died to getting what he thought he deserved. And he became alive to getting what I don't deserve because of the grace of the giver, that is God. So whenever Jacob gave up turning to his own resources, that is when he began to receive the benefits of God's resources. We should persist in prayer, but not because God is reluctant to bless us. We persist because doing so expresses our faith in our generous God. It expresses our trust in God's perfect timing. And it expresses our ability or our capacity to enjoy those blessings that He provides to us. An appeal to grace, or an appeal to God through grace, says this: nothing in my hands I bring. An appeal through legalism, though, says something in my hands I bring.
Come on.
Like, we have something to offer God in exchange for His grace. We have nothing.
Amen.
That we can get. The only thing that we have is our faith and trust in Jesus Christ today. God hates this legalistic view when we think that there's things that we can do to warrant favor with Him. When we do so, we make it look as though God's love is for sale, that it's something that we can buy.
Come on.
We can earn a paycheck and offer it to God to receive His blessings, to receive His grace. But His love is not for sale today. It's not some prize that's given to moral winners. It's not some reward for great spiritual performance that we give on this earth today. But God's love flows from His heart. And we don't have to wrestle it out of God like Jacob tried to do. So this morning, maybe we're in our metaphorical scala sancta. We're trying to climb stairs on our knees to receive God's blessing. But it's time to step down off of those stairs and realize that it's not what we can do for God that earns our favor, but it's who we are in Christ Jesus that brings about our blessings. It is being the sons and daughters of our Most High God through our faith and trust in Jesus Christ that brings about the loving favor of God on our lives. So again, we need to climb down from those sacred stairs. We need to end maybe a self-inflicted guilt trip we have on ourselves in our own efforts. Turn away from our own efforts. Get rid of these legalistic tendencies we have to try to do things to earn God's favor, to earn God's grace, to earn God's mercy today. We need to flip that switch from legalism to grace. We need to stop trying to put an effort for God to earn His blessings and look to God's loving kindness. And look to that grace and mercy that He so freely gives through faith and trust in Jesus Christ. We need to thank God that He blesses us not only because of who and what He is, never because of who and what we are. God had to dislocate Jacob's hip to make him realize this.
Amen.
What is it that God would have to do to you to make you to realize this?
Come on.
It was so important. God got to the point to where this destructive thinking was so damaging to Jacob's life. This self-reliance that he had. that God came down and intervened firsthand. Seemingly, again, at the most lowest point in his life, but it was the point where he needed a God encounter to change his life. He'd always tried to rely on his own ability to earn God's favor and God's blessing to help him in times of hardship and especially this time of judgment. But he knew that it was going to end in disaster. And if we today try to look to our own efforts to earn God's favor, to earn God's blessing, to earn his grace and mercy from our time of judgment, we too would be heading for disaster. God had to touch Jacob's hip to bring him to the place of realizing that he could never earn God's grace and mercy. I pray that God touches every one of us today however he needs to open our eyes and help us to fully see that his grace and mercy, that his love is not for sale. There's nothing that we can do of ourselves to earn that paycheck, to buy God's love, to buy God's grace, to buy God's mercy today. It is by faith and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ, who shed his blood to save us. It is a free gift that God gives to us, that we may not boast, saying, like Jacob, he thought that he was earning something. He probably would have been proud of that. But God tells us that it is a free gift that none of us can boast. But give glory to God for that which he freely gives us out of love and compassion for every one of us today. And I want to close by saying this. God loves each and every one of you. And if there is anyone here today who has not received Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, and you feel that natural tendency, just like Adam and Eve did at the very beginning, that there's something that you have to do, some habits that you have to kick, some things that you have to get right in your life before Jesus can accept you, that's a false thinking.
Amen, man.
God, it says in his word, when we were yet sinners, Christ died.
Yes, amen.
He died for you just as you are. Because he loves you today just as you are. Amen. There's nothing that you have to try to do to earn God's forgiveness today. And we should be thankful for that, because there is nothing we can do of ourselves to earn that forgiveness. All you have to do is look to Jesus Christ, the one who shed his blood on Calvary for you. Look to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Realize your desperate need for him as your Lord and Savior. Accept and receive him. Turn in forgiveness, seeking forgiveness for your sins. And the blood of Jesus Christ can cover you and wash you. Can send those sins as far as the east is from the west, that you can find forgiveness of those sins and be saved from an eternal judgment of hell and be brought into a relationship with a loving Heavenly Father and become sons and daughters of the Most High God this morning.
Amen.
If you will, please stand with me. I'm going to have every head bowed and every eye closed for just a few moments. We see in Jacob's example that he thought that there was something he could do to get out of the circumstances he was in. And he tried everything he could by his own power to get out of those circumstances. But in the end, he realized there was nothing that he could do to escape the judgment of his brother. And the same thing with us here today. There is nothing that we can do to escape the judgment of eternal hell because of our sins. But God, in his love, grace, and mercy for us, offers forgiveness. As I mentioned, that comes with simply taking that step of faith, trusting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If you're here today and God's working in your heart, isn't it for you? Do not pass up that opportunity. Today is the day. Tomorrow is not promised. For anyone here that has not said that Jesus Christ is the Lord and Savior, that will come. I mentioned before, it's tough for us in the flesh. We have that natural bent desire to want to try to do things our own way, earn favor with God. If that's you today, I would pray that you would look to lay down your own efforts and look to God. Is there anyone here? The altars are open. Does anyone have any need at all? Or if you just want to spend time in prayer with the Lord, the altars are open. As I was kind of praying and thinking on this message for today, there was a word that came to me in regards to this. This is what God had spoken to me in regards to this message. We do not strive to live our lives for God as an application for His grace and mercy. We strive to live our lives for God as appreciation for His grace and mercy.
Amen.
Amen. Yes. Amen. Come on, amen.
And let's remember that as we go out through this life, not knowing that it's not what we do that earns us favor, that earns us God's grace and mercy. It's who we are.
Amen.
His sons and daughters, brought into the family by our faith and trust in Jesus Christ. Amen.
Amen.
Does anybody have anything they want to add before we close this morning? All right, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father in heaven, we thank you once again for this blessed opportunity we have to receive your word today. Lord, first we thank you, Father, for reminding us how your wonderful grace and mercy and forgiveness that comes our way, Lord, is not earned by anything that we do. But Lord, it is freely given out of compassionate love for us as we look to your Son, Jesus Christ, as our Lord and Savior, as we walk in faith and trust in you every day. Lord, what liberty that gives us, Father. Lord, that we have not the need to try to wrestle and fight blessings out of you, Father, but just look to you, Father, and cling to you in faith and trust, Father, that you, the good, good Father that you are, so openly bestow the grace and mercy and the blessings upon us that you do. Lord, may we continue as Jacob started, acknowledging, Father, Lord, that it is your goodness, Lord, that it is undeserving of us, Father, the grace and mercy that you have, Father. Lord, Father, help us to not turn to our own devices and our own ways as we saw Jacob try to do, but always understanding and knowing, Father, Lord, that it is you and your love that goes with us and before us, Father, that leads, guides, and directs us in grace and mercy. Reminding us, Father, Lord, that it's not what we do, but again, it's just who that we are, Father. I just pray that you would go with us as we leave this place. Lord, thank you for always being ever present with us wherever we go. Lord, pray that you would continue to give us wisdom and boldness, Father, to be faithful witnesses for you, Father. Lead and guide and direct us and protect us and keep us healthy, Lord, until we meet again. It's just in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Mm-hmm.